All right. Sorry to cut T-Swift so short, but with it being 6:03, it's time for us to get started. So I just wanted to give us a chance to say hello and welcome to the webinar. And if you're here, you've made it successfully. I know it's 6:03 here on the East Coast, but wherever you are, whether you're watching live or on demand from your couch, dorm, home, office, from wherever you are in the world, a really big welcome to all of you joining us today for our Demystifying Entry-Level Sales Careers webinar. And that's a mouthful to say, so I'm glad you're still here with us. So to introduce myself, if we haven't met already, either on the phone or through a previous webinar or just in passing, my name is Chantha Chak, and I am a campus recruiter here at HubSpot. And if you haven't heard about HubSpot before, something to know about us is our grand mission is to help millions of organizations grow better through our inbound methodology and our all-in-one growth platform that you can see through our four hubs here. And while we'd love to talk about HubSpot a little bit more, and while we want to focus more on the growth of our organizations that we're helping, we're also here to help you grow better as well through our webinar series. So this is especially hopefully helpful for you, especially as you're trying to explore a variety of careers like sales, which is what we're exploring today. So I'm happy to have all of you join us. And I would love to also kind of welcome along with us for the ride. Joining us today is a crew of people from our HubSpot community that are excited for a couple things, to share their journeys as well as their experience in sales here at HubSpot. So I'd love to give you a chance to meet them. And so here's what I'm gonna do. I'm just gonna turn on their video so that they're able to come on and meet everybody. So you should be able to do that now. And I'd love each of our folks to say hello by sharing your name, how long you've been at HubSpot, and also a little description of what your current role is. So who would like to go first?
I'll go first. Hey, everybody. My name is Flora. I'm currently a product manager at HubSpot. So I'm working as building the sales product, but previously I started in HubSpot as a customer support specialist, so helping customers out. And my sales career was a sales engineer, so being a technical consultant in-house is awesome sales reps.
Thanks for coming, Flora. Appreciate having you here.
Thanks for having me.
Why don't I throw it to DJ first, who's first on the slide?
All right. I throw my video on?
Yeah, go ahead. Should be able to.
Right. Hey, what's up, guys? I'm DJ. I'm an account executive at HubSpot. Been here almost 5 years. So my job is to sign on new business. I'm in the small business segment, so I work with companies who are about 1 to 25 employee size, and my job is to help them evaluate HubSpot and, you know, get them signed up. So I run the full process of qualifying them as a company and running them through our sales process and signing them on. Excited to chat with you guys, and thanks for hopping on. I'm also a Providence College Friar. I see like 3 or 4 Friars on here. Gets me fired up, but that's it.
Woo! Awesome. Thanks, DJ. Thanks for joining us.
Yeah.
Jen or Dana, who wants to go next?
I guess I could kick it off here. Let's see. Yeah, so yeah, everybody, my name is Jenner. I've been at HubSpot since May of last year. I actually started off as an ISC, which was an entry-level sales position, sales and support position, and I was catering more towards the Latin American and North American market. I've just recently been promoted a couple of months ago to BDR, so now I do corporate sales for the Northeast territory. Just trying to find new business for account executives like DJ to close.
Exciting. And Jenner, you're being so modest, but we've also been thankful for you to help to grow the LATAM Inbound Success Coach team. And in fact, you've not only helped us grow that team, you've helped us launch the team too. So a huge thanks for that, and also for joining us today too. So
pleasure's all mine.
Yeah. Cool. Last but not least, Dana, how about you? Hello.
Hello, my name is Dana Starr. I am a renewal manager at HubSpot, which basically means once a customer is already a customer and they're up for renewal, I negotiate their next contract and also work on, you know, getting them suited with the best product suite. So hopefully more products with HubSpot. I started at HubSpot in September 2016, and I was the 5th renewal manager that they hired. So I've kind of helped build the team and kind of bring us to where we are today. And I also saw that there was one person from Michigan State. I went to Michigan State, so just wanted to give that person a shout out.
Woo! OG renewal manager.
Go green, go white.
Way to go, Dana. Awesome. So thank you all just for joining us. And I know we've got some busy schedules, but we're excited that you're here to share your experience. And a lot of our panelists here have started in an entry-level sales role, but also a lot of our friends have also worked with sales in a number of different ways too. So excited to dive deep into what careers look like, as well as what our culture here helps our sales work. So massive welcome to the four of you. So before we jump into our actual discussions, I just wanted to jump through some quick housekeeping items. Whoops, went far ahead. I always do that. So the first housekeeping items, if you haven't joined us for a Zoom webinar before, there are a few buttons on your screen at the bottom of your window that you'll have accessible to you. And those are the only tools that you'll use throughout our time for the next 45 minutes or so. So one of the things that we want to check out first is the chat feature, which I see that a lot of us have already been using. If you haven't chimed in to say hello, what your name is, and where you're logging in from, we highly encourage you to do so. As we've seen, we've had some great representation across the US, and looking to see if we have anyone logged on internationally. We'll find out for sure, but massive welcome to all of you who are chatting in there. But we're gonna use this to not only introduce ourselves, but also if you have some comments that you wanna share and interact with the rest of the attendees here at the event, please feel free to use this space. You may also use this to also chat with us as panelists in case you have questions just for us, but purely just use this to interact with each other throughout the next 45 minutes or so. So there's that. You're also going to see a Q&A box. So at the end of our session today, we're gonna have a live Q&A with our panelists so that you can ask as many questions as we have time for to talk about anything we didn't cover throughout the next 45 minutes. So please make sure to use just the Q&A box if you'd like us to ask questions during the Q&A. We won't use the chat to find those questions. We're gonna use only the Q&A box. So please make sure you put your questions in there, and you can submit them anonymously. So in case you don't want us to reveal your name, you can just put them there anonymously. And then last but not least, there is a button for raising your hand. So we're gonna use that occasionally just to kind of allow you to interact in another way as well. So you can feel free if you wanna actually go ahead and hit raise hand in your control panel. Go ahead and try to use that right now. That works for you. I see some raised hands. Great. Cool. And the number's growing. Awesome. So just so you know, we're going to have some questions where you can do that, but I'm just going to lower all hands right now just to reset us all. And it looks like some of you are already doing that. So that's great. Cool. But yeah, but those are the three tools that you're going to use throughout the next, next 45 minutes, as we say. So please interact with us in those few ways, and you'll be good to go. So with that, without further ado, are we ready to jump into the agenda? Raise your hand if you do. Okay, cool. All right, here we go. Cool. Oh, I meant raise your hand in the Zoom, not in over the video. I saw that, Jenner. All right, so we're gonna lower the hands right now, and let's get started with just the agenda for tonight. So just so you know what we're gonna cover for the rest of the hour, we're gonna go through mainly panel discussions. There's less of a presentation and more time for us to chat with our panelists, since that was some of the great feedback we got from our first webinar. So we're gonna have mainly a panel discussion with our panelists here, and then we'll have a quick chat around kind of roles as well as application next steps, and then do our live Q&A at the same time. So that's what we'll have on deck for the rest of the hour. And with that, we are ready to start by talking about all things sales at HubSpot. So let's kind of start by actually talking about some common myths at HubSpot, or not at HubSpot, but in sales at HubSpot or otherwise. I think one of the things that really drew me to this topic was actually Flora, who kind of popularized this topic for a lot of us here in the sales world. So we have four common myths that we want to kind of talk about as a group. So to reveal them right now, here's what they are. So myth number one, sales reps are only pushing you to spend more money. Myth number two, sales reps are only extroverted. Okay, heard that here and there. Before going into sales, you have to have previous sales experience. You would think that too. Okay, I get that. And then lastly, sales teams are not diverse. So let's kind of have a candid conversation with our panelists and just talk about, like, how have they seen maybe these either not true or what's kind of things we want to talk about and how it's kind of different here at HubSpot. So I'll let the team sound off on kind of what are your thoughts on as you see these myths on screen. Who wants to start?
I can kick it off. I think the previous sales experience one, I've seen a lot of people at HubSpot just come in who totally decide to switch careers. I think, you know, one thing that's good about HubSpot and a lot of, you know, tech companies is, you know, sometimes you're in a different department, whether it's, you know, accounting, customer success, and you decide, hey, I want to give sales a try. I think, you know, it's something that doesn't require previous experience. I think it's just someone that has to be a hard worker and open to trying new things. I think with sales, you know, if you learn your product and what you're trying to do, I mean, I think it's definitely something that you can get into. I know, you know, there's only just starting to be colleges that offer sales degrees. I know when I was in school, I studied marketing and, you know, I ended up in sales. So it's, you know, just one thing that I want to chime in about. I don't know if you guys want to take anything else.
Sure. So I was going to talk through, you have to have previous sales experience. Yeah. So before HubSpot, I was a BDR at a different company. But before that, I was in school and I studied to be a teacher. So obviously that has nothing to do with sales. So I think it was hard for me to kind of, after I finished school, I felt bad for my parents, but I decided I didn't want to be a teacher. And it was hard to gain the confidence to apply for a job that I felt like I didn't have any talk tracks on. So my recommendation to anyone would just be to, you know, take the interview, do some research, talk to as many people as you can. And you don't have to be glued to whatever your major is or whatever you're thinking you want to go forward with.
I like that. And that actually kind of talks about before a little bit about how like sales teams aren't diverse. I actually tend to think it's the opposite, especially at HubSpot, where like DJ and Dana, you already talked about how like you don't come from traditional sales backgrounds, and Jenner and Flora, I know you don't also. Jenner, you have a great kind of story about how you studied in Japan before coming to HubSpot, and Flora, yeah, biochemistry. So like, do you guys want to talk about that a little bit?
Yeah, sure. Actually, before joining HubSpot, I was actually living in Japan for a couple of years, for 5 years in total, actually. And I didn't have a sales background as well. I was actually working there as a teacher, teaching elementary and junior high school kids English. And then when wanted to come back to the United States, I, you know, wanted to join a company like HubSpot that emphasizes so much on growth. And what I realized is that just when I got here, it's just the diversity from all countries around, you know, we are a global company. So we have 7 or 8 different offices around the world. And I mean, doesn't matter what kind of experience you have in the past. I've met stand-up comedians here, aviation pilots, so many different kinds of backgrounds from different places. Yeah.
Love that. And then Flora, like your biochemistry background, like I know we've talked about it together here and there, but like how did you find out about like sales from biochemistry? Like that's also a different.
Yeah, definitely wasn't like a one-to-one step there. I think overall, when I left college, I was looking for like a really invigorating field to join. And while biochemistry is very cool, I feel like just tech has that fast-moving aspect and just really intrigued me. So joining HubSpot entry-level and kind of a different role in customer support, but I found my way to sales just because it's actually really intellectual in the same way. It's like a lot of problem solving. And even though I wrote this whole list, I think the biggest one I actually... Oh, they're all big, but I think the first one is the biggest thing I learned about sales is that it's not just about pushing people to spend more money. You know, you negotiate other things too. And having worked most closely with DJ on this panel, I'd say like there are plenty of deals and plenty of things that we were like, hey, this is not worth the time to keep going on. So I think it really teaches you that it's actually more about problem solving, time management, and not so much about, you know, just kind of this like car salesman image that a lot of people have. And that way, when you kind of look at sales from that lens, it actually has a lot more similarities with like more academic subjects like biochemistry than people would think.
I love that. And I think I want to unpack like the first myth there, because something that really just, you know, got me on board with like sales at HubSpot was just the fact that we're not in this like always be closing mentality. Like we're not always trying to force deals. Instead, we're actually just trying to do what's best for the person in front of us. And that's our way to kind of build relationships there. So do you guys can you guys speak to the fact that like, we're not, you know, pushers in a way, and that we're actually much different than being a pusher?
I mean, some of the best sales reps here, just overall in HubSpot are, like you said, not always be closing, but always be helping is sort of like the motto that we do here. And I think DJ could attest to that, that the more you could help out trying to solve the problems, as Flora was saying, that the customer is having, the more successful you're going to be.
Yeah, I think, you know, one benefit of working at HubSpot is we obviously have such an awesome brand, and our marketing team does such a great job that people who come across us already have a good impression of us. And, you know, it's really up to us to figure out, you know, can we help them, can we not? And obviously we have both free and paid products. So a lot of times we get someone using our free services, they enjoy it, and then we upgrade them later when the timing's right. But I think so many people love HubSpot, and it just is always a natural fit when you start talking about some of our products.
That's awesome. Yeah, I think that's one of the things that got me to think about sales as not being this evil empire anymore, that there are actually people out there who are human and authentic and actually want what's best for me. So that's really been the biggest flip for me when it came to working with our sales team here. So thank you guys for representing that every day.
Thanks,
no problem.
Yeah. And I think number two also is, that's what also kind of initially scared me about sales was, I know I come off as like an extroverted person. That's what I thought was going to be what I was going to see mostly when I went onto a sales team. But have you found that like most of your kind of teammates in sales have been extroverted, or do you see a mix? What's that been like for you guys?
I would say a few years ago when I started, I've been here about 5 years. I mean, it was mainly extroverts, but I think I've noticed that there's a lot more balance now between introverts and extroverts. I don't think you have to be super outgoing and, you know, super loud, because a lot of times we deal with a lot of technical sales and creative and consultative processes where someone who's super smart and creative could do really well. So I think there's definitely a good balance there.
I like that a lot. Yeah, because I feel like if everyone was all extroverted, that doesn't also lend us to be a little bit diverse in terms of experience or personality there too. So I think that's where I like to see that too. So yeah. But I think we all kind of talked about like some good points here, but anything else that you guys want to add around your thoughts on these myths?
Yeah, and I think a big thing is that like you're selling to real people too, and like real people are so many different aspects, right? It's just like they are introverts or extroverts, they come from all these diverse backgrounds. So it's not like the stereotypical image of sales is a one size fits all, because realistically, like the person you're trying to connect with is not just like this cookie cutter image either.
And while I can't speak for every company that does sales, I think I'm really proud that like HubSpot is the kind of place that, you know, likes to debunk a lot of these myths here. So Flora, I thank you for this article that talked about these myths and helped me kind of open my eyes to like what sales could be and where HubSpot kind of falls into that. So I'm super proud that like we are thinking differently in terms of sales there. So yeah, why don't we move on to our next kind of topic, now that we've kind of debunked some of those myths, and just talk about career growth. I know just from my chats with candidates and folks in sales, one of the main questions that we get is, you know, how does someone grow their career here at HubSpot? And I think we have a panel that represents a number of different growth paths here that I'd love to kind of unpack a little bit more. So we don't have to choose who goes first, but I'd love to have all of us kind of talk about how did you get your start at HubSpot? And we've kind of talked about this a little bit, but let's unpack that a little bit more now that we have the time. But yeah, who wants to go first in terms of how you got your start at HubSpot?
I can go first.
Take it off.
Oh,
Sandy, go ahead.
Okay, thank you.
I'll go.
Okay, so I have a funny story, actually. So I was looking for a new job, and I saw that HubSpot was having a kind of meet and greet event in Boston to meet with the recruiting team and sales reps and a group of people. And on my way to work that morning, I was talking to my mom on the phone, and I told her I was going. And she said, "I can't believe you're going. I just bought HubSpot yesterday for my company." Wow. "And I absolutely loved my sales rep. I'm going to introduce you to him." So she introduces me to someone at HubSpot. His name is Chris, and he still works here. And we emailed back and forth a few times. He was super friendly. I met up with him at the meet and greet event. We met, and he introduced me to a few other people there, came in for interviews the next week, and started HubSpot a month later. And as I said, I was the fifth renewal manager. And since then, I've moved on to be a senior renewal manager. And now I'm a team lead on the renewal management team, which basically means I assist my manager when he is busy or he needs to pass some things off for me. So I think that that's really important to show that as you're, if you overperform and if you show interest, there's tons of career opportunities at HubSpot, especially in leadership.
Awesome. And we're going to dive deeper into kind of like how you chose to go the team lead route in a few minutes. So
okay,
we're going to talk about that.
Okay.
DJ, I think you wanted to go next.
Or you sure. Yeah, I'd say, you know, just kicking off, all you seniors, everyone who's on here, hats off to you for just being super proactive and getting out of your career. I know, admittedly, for me, I was not looking for jobs senior year. I was just enjoying the college experience, and then I started getting going after I graduated. So you guys, hats off to that. But same. I know with me, so I studied marketing. I really didn't know what I wanted to do when I got out, and started looking around for jobs. Ended up actually taking a job doing door-to-door sales, selling Verizon cable. So that was my first job out of school. And I started in the summer. It was super fun, but then it got cold. And it really taught me that I wanted to do sales. It just was, I needed to get in a better industry. So I had a lot of friends in tech. Knew one girl that also went to Providence who worked at HubSpot, and applied through her. And you know, I got in, started February 2015. And I've had a few roles since. I was actually similar to Jenner. I was an inbound sales rep. So doing chats on the website, fielding calls, just learning HubSpot, and then became a business development representative. So just, you know, doing calls, warming up accounts for the account executives. And then I've been an AE for the last 3 years. So, you know, it's just been a cool growth pattern since I started. And I've just learned a lot about sales and, you know, didn't think leaving school that I'd end up in it, but it's been great. And I, you know, wouldn't change it for a thing.
That's awesome. That's awesome. I know it seems like the power of networking is happening just from what you and Dana talked about. So that's really cool. And actually, like with Flora and Jenner, like how did you kind of find out about HubSpot? Like why HubSpot after you spent your time in Japan or like right from college? Like what made you like say, I need to go to HubSpot? Like what gave you that like light bulb?
Yeah, sure. So when I was living abroad, I actually applied internationally when I was living in Tokyo. I've pretty much, when I was doing my search to look for jobs in the United States, pretty much was looking for a company that's going to help me grow, top company in the United States. And I pretty much just went on Glassdoor, took a look at all the list of companies there. I mean, HubSpot's been ranked in the top 10 of the best places to work for the last maybe 4 or 5 years running. And then my girlfriend, she had told me that she had known somebody who worked at HubSpot. Since after I mentioned that this is a place that I was considering, she made an introduction, and I actually got my foot in the door to speak with the sales manager in Latin America, who was David Torres. And I was pretty much got in contact with him, kicked it off, had a great relationship. I actually applied for the Latin American BDR position at first. Long story short, there was a need to fill the Latin American ISC position because the market was growing rapidly. Mm-hmm. So I decided to take that. And after making a move here, as Vinny mentioned earlier, the Latin American market grew substantially. And we actually had to hire a few ISCs over in our new Bogota office that opened up last year. So I was one of the preferred people that leadership actually like sent me over to Bogota to interview some of the new ISCs that we currently have over there now. And then after I did that mission successfully, I was able to promote internally to the role I'm in right now as BDR. So it's been an amazing ride.
Well, we're gonna definitely talk about kind of how your journey's been in a little bit. So we're no spoiler alerts. Cool, how about you, Flora? How did you find out about HubSpot from Brandeis where you were?
Yeah, definitely. So when I went to undergrad at Brandeis, and I saw someone in the chat also went to Brandeis, so hello to them. I was studying biochemistry, which is like a pretty left field compared to tech in general. And even though it's technical in its own way, by no means did I understand like how software or websites would work at all. So when I was looking for a role and looking to switch industries, like kind of right out of college, I just really randomly heard from a friend, like, they also worked in software, and they're like, hey, here's a really cool culture there. And This is the part where I was like, aha, they were like, they'll take people who have talent and potential, but they may not know the exact pieces. And I was like, wow. Because I was so in this mentality of like, I need to use my degree or use my exact classroom learnings for a career. And I just found it was awesome to see that there's companies who are willing to take chances on people who are willing to work really hard. So I started in customer support, which is other entry level role in learning the product really well and helping customers day in and day out. Definitely, I wasn't used to talking to people all the time. That really kind of broke me out of my shell and got me really good at being able to talk to people, empathize with them, and really understand their needs. From there, I joined sales as a sales engineer. So as like a technical consultant in-house to people like DJ and other sales reps, helping them close deals as well as working with prospects. So, and that was like truly an awesome way to really jump into sales as well too. And just really being able to be helpful and also seeing like firsthand what it takes to close a deal.
That's awesome. And so obviously that kind of nicely segues into this next question around like, okay, so how have you grown since then? Because there's a lot of opportunities in our sales org and across HubSpot to really grow your career, whether it's in role, like Dana's doing, where she's currently a senior renewals manager, but she's also taking on a team lead experience. I know DJ and Jenner have gone through a lot of great promotions within our sales org, from being an inbound success coach to where they are now, whether it's an account executive or BDR. And then Flora has been able to experience like so many different areas, just from customer support to sales and now our product organization. So I'd love to now just kind of dig into that, because I know like a lot of us like are really itching to know, like, what are those ways that like you really grow careers, and like how did you like get there? So we'll love to spend some time just talking about that with each of you. So I'll leave it to you guys to kick it off there.
Yeah, I'd say one thing that people, it's always, you know, somebody's gonna work hard and be likable. Those are the two things that I always live by. Like, if you're consistent and reliable and people like being around you, like, you're naturally going to find yourself, you know, in a position to, you know, open up a new role or join another team. So I think just, you know, being genuine. And, you know, for me, like when I started, I asked a lot of questions, like, who are the people that were in the next role that I want to get to? Like, just find out, how did they get there? You know, I think just having as many conversations as you can, you know, making sure people know who you are, and just obviously, like, you know, doing what you have to do in terms of metrics, but also just being well known and just putting yourself in the position, you know, to get that next role, just like you guys are doing. Like, you're joining a webinar, some of you are, you know, trying to apply for HubSpot, like, you're taking that step to make yourself known. So those are just a quick couple nuggets for me.
DJ, do you mind just kind of walking through like what your path has been from being an inbound sales coordinator to where you are now? Like, what were kind of the roles that you had?
Yeah, so inbound sales coordinator to start. So when we have anyone who chats in on the website or calls in asking about product questions, you know, account questions, I'm on the front line. So for any of you Game of Thrones fans, I always said we were defending the wall. So anything we got, you know, we would just pass along. And, you know, it was good because there was no quota associated with it. So it really gave you a chance to take a step back, have sales conversations, and not have the pressure of having to, you know, get them to that next step. It was just really natural. And I really learned a lot in terms of product and tech, because, you know, the job I was doing before, I didn't have any previous tech experience, which goes back to what we were talking about before. So it really helped me to learn that business acumen and, you know, that fast moving tech, you know, kind of setup. And then did that for about 6 months, and then became a BDR, business development representative. So for there, I was supporting 3 account executives. That was about 15 months in that role. And really with that, it's just a lot of calling and emailing, trying to get people who have been to the HubSpot website, they've shown interest. Maybe one of my reps identified them as a good fit for HubSpot. So you're really just trying to warm up those accounts and really get them to a point where they are ready to evaluate HubSpot. And then from there, you pass it along to a rep to, you know, go ahead and try and get them set up with HubSpot. And then now, you know, as an account executive, you really run that full process of, you know, reaching out, talking to them when they first come across HubSpot, doing a first kind of initial discovery call where you understand what type of company are they, what are their priorities. And, you know, the good thing about HubSpot is we have so many different products that a lot of times there's different ways to kind of fit them into a specific product. From there, it's, you know, doing a demo, sharing your screen like we're doing on Zoom, and, you know, walking them through HubSpot. You know, what are the things that they're going to use? You know, is it a good fit for them? And then from there, it's, you know, figuring out next steps, which is typically negotiating. So figuring out what products they need, getting them signed up on HubSpot, and then, you know, that's when the fun stuff starts. So that's kind of my path, and yeah.
That's awesome. So you've experienced a lot just in a short amount of time. Even though you're reaching sabbatical and you've been here for 5 years, you've still reached a lot of like great movement just within a short period of time, which is awesome. And
yeah,
that's so great.
And I think it's good that the one thing that I love about sales is, you know, especially HubSpot, is you know exactly what you need to do to get to the next level. There's no politics involved. There's no, you know, I got to have so many conversations. It's like, if you, you know, reach X amount of software sold, then you know, you get bumped up. So that's why I like sales, you know, personally.
And it's one of those professions where like you get what you put into it. For the most part, it's very much directly correlated, and that's what I love kind of just talking about. And it's great that you've had that path. And Jenner, I know you've just made the move from ISC to BDR. So what's kind of been like that path been like for you, and how have you been adjusting so far?
Yeah, I mean, I loved it when I started off as an ISC, just because, as DJ said, I think it's the perfect position and like entry-level sales position, because you're getting best of both worlds. You're understanding the HubSpot product inside and out to help customers with any other pain points they're establishing, but also you're trying to not just go high, like surface-level kind of questions, but you're actually digging deeper, trying to understand certain pain points that companies are facing, and illustrating how HubSpot can help. So having that experience as an ISC was fantastic, and which really helped me actually like move on to this next level as a BDR. Having that product knowledge in the background, anytime I hear certain challenges or bottleneck issues that these companies are facing, I already know the product inside and out in the back of my head, and I know exactly what it could solve for. I know exactly what HubSpot can solve for, and continue to illustrate that for the customer. So it, starting off as an ISC and going to BDR, it's been just best of both worlds experience for sure.
So, and how long have you been a BDR, Jenner?
It's been about 5 months.
Nice.
Yeah, 5 months so far.
Cool. On that way to PBDR, principal BDR, right?
Yes, indeed.
Cool. Dana, now you started as a renewal manager, the OG renewal manager, and now you're at senior level and you've explored the team lead experience. So can you tell us about kind of like what that path has been like and how being a team lead has been so far?
Sure. So DJ said something similar to this earlier, where he said, you know, there's, you know, exactly what you have to do and there's no office politics. Someone once said to me that at HubSpot, the best idea wins. There's no kind of politics behind it. So, when I was a renewal manager, I love the day-to-day of my job, but I also like that I'm on a new team where we're working on, you know, the structure of our program and how we, you know, manage things on the day to day. So I started to kind of work on the program as well as being a renewal manager. And what I found was that the best idea did win. And if I had an idea or the director of renewal management had an idea, if he liked my idea, you know, my idea kind of pushed forward. And I think that HubSpot does that so well. So I was able to kind of be valued as a leader. And I moved on to be a team lead, which has been a great experience.
That's awesome. And how long have you been a team lead so far, Dana?
8 months.
Wow. That's incredible. Mm-hmm.
Yes.
And is it a permanent thing or is it like a certain number of months?
Yeah. So in sales, they do, which is another thing that I love, they do team lead for 6 months. So it's a rotating position. So a bunch of people can try it out. In renewal management, we do one team lead for the whole department. And I was given the opportunity to do it twice, but you can only max out twice. So there will be a new person in the role in 4 months, which I think is an amazing opportunity for that person, but also for HubSpot, because as I said, it's just a constant flow of ideas and how can we make HubSpot better? How can we make the customer experience better? How can we make our product better? And it's all about just like hearing everyone out.
And it sets you up for a foundation for when a management role does come up. So I'm very excited for your future.
Thank you.
And just to add to that for Dana, I love that she said like the best idea wins. When they were thinking about having the ISC position in Latin America or here in North America, I actually spoke with the director of our team. And I mentioned, hey man, this position belongs somewhere else. It should not be in North America. It should be long in Bogota, in Bogota office. And just because of that, he loved the idea, and he's actually implemented that, that an all new headcount moving forward would be in a new office. So best idea definitely wins at HubSpot.
Jenner, people are asking you questions. What is an ISC and what was the transition like from ISC to BDR?
Yeah, so inbound success, ISC is an inbound success coach. It's pretty much hands-on. It's the first people, when you go into HubSpot.com, the first people you're going to be interacting with is most likely going to be an ISC. We have a little chat bot on our webpage. We have our team of people who are chatting with you if you have any questions, or if you call into HubSpot, you'll most likely be answered by an ISC. So we do half of support, half of sales, answering any questions and trying to pretty much make it book a meeting, or if there's any opportunity for growth, or, you know, you pass that information along to the account executive like DJ, where he'll take a little deeper dive into it.
Nice, which is very different from a BDR in that BDRs are going out to find those new potential fits for HubSpot. So
right.
BDRs are purely outbound, whereas ISCs are purely mainly inbound, which is what's in the title, so that's good. Yeah. And I know we've been using inbound sales coordinator and inbound success coach interchangeably. They're actually one and the same as a role. We did go through some evolutions over the years, so if we've kind of said those interchangeably, that's kind of why. So that's cool. Great call out, Dana. With that. Flora, I wanted to make sure that we were able to talk about your experience too, because, you know, you've gone through like a lot of mobility throughout HubSpot too, both within sales and outside of sales. So like, can you tell us about that unique journey too?
Yeah, definitely. It's definitely pretty unique to have have gone through like three totally different departments at HubSpot, from customer success to sales to where I'm now in the product org of building the product and working with engineers itself. And yeah, I think there's a lot of just core skills that kind of transcend the specific role at HubSpot. So I think it's really awesome that like this feeling you're now of like, hey, you know, I'm not sure what I want to do next. Like, it's almost a good thing that doesn't go away sometimes. Like, it's not like you land your first job and you'll just have this like deep sense of destiny that you know exactly what you'll do for the rest of your life. And it's okay that's not. And HubSpot's pretty open about like career growth and having people like move around in different departments as well too. So ultimately, like, I really loved being on the sales team and it was a great time, but I want to go deeper on one area of the product and really feel a sense of ownership of changing specific areas of the product, which is why I had made the move from sales and into product engineering.
That's cool. And you're working in our sales hub, which is exciting. Yes. So you still get to work with our sales team.
Yeah, exactly. So the detail there is that I work on the sales hub, so specifically the product for salespeople, who are all of our customers, including our internal customers, which is everybody else on this panel and everybody, all other salespeople at HubSpot too. So that's really awesome.
And evolving what sales hub is and what it will be in the future. So we thank you for that partnership there. If there's anyone that was a better partner, it's Flora. So cool. So I love just hearing about all the different ways that you've grown your career, both in role and outside of role. So I'd love to now kind of shift gears a little bit and just talk about some other things that we've talked about here and there too, which is our team culture at HubSpot, especially within sales. We're proud to be a top winning sales team in terms of our culture. So to hear a little bit more about kind of your experiences there, I'd love to just dig a little bit deeper into kind of what's the day-to-day like in your role and with your teams. So I'll have you guys sound off.
Jenner, I think everyone's very eager to hear from you based on the Q&A.
Yeah, I definitely got to answer some of these questions. But what is your day-to-day like in your role with the team? I mean, day-to-day, as a BDR now, it's pretty, it all starts with the beginning. Like, the first couple of days, the first couple of weeks, first couple of months, it's all about setting, like, a foundation, a core principle that you're, to stay organized, that you're going to follow. You know, you change up your strategy every once in a while, but it's very important to stay consistent in the BDR role, and trust in the process. Shout out to any 76ers fans, but trust the process for sure. Because that's what's going to lead you to be successful. Day to day, really, it's mostly going through certain views, trying to see who's had any kind of interactions with HubSpot, any warm touches that have come into the funnel, reach out to them through calls or emails, And then going out and proactively searching for new companies who might be a good fit for HubSpot as well. And sharing that information with your reps that you work really closely with. I work with 4 reps right now, spread across like the Northeast territory in the United States. And just actively, you know, communicating with your rep every day, to see what's the next good fit, next target that you want to go after.
Nice. And what's that dynamic like working with an account executive? Because you are working with a handful of them. So like, is it unique with each person? Is it pretty like, is the energy like good between all three of you? Like what's that like?
I'm very fortunate to love the team that I'm working with. Our synergy is, you know, we held each other accountable. We're very results oriented, so we like to see results on the board, and pretty much I scratch their back, they scratch my back, and we look after each other. 2 of my reps work remote. One is in Arizona and one is in Alabama. And the other 2 reps are here in the office, in the Cambridge office. But every Wednesday, we pretty much meet for our one-on-one. So it's, we actually just do like a group chat together and discuss how all the results or all the things that we're doing, how can we pretty much be better as well.
Nice. Cool. And I know, Jenny, you got some good questions in the Q&A, so we'll definitely get to the rest of them, or we'll try to get to the rest of them in the Q&A. If not, we will definitely answer them via email. So no, don't fret if we don't get to answer everybody. So
absolutely.
Yeah, so it's cool. How about Dana, what about you? Like, what's your day-to-day like working in renewals? Because it's like a new area that like a lot of people don't really know a lot about. So like, what's that like?
Sure. So renewals is kind of in between the sales and the customer success organization. I work very closely with a few customer success reps, along with a large handful of sales reps. My day-to-day usually consists of having meetings with customers via Zoom to discuss their renewal, it's kind of like their check-in. It's like, okay, it's been a year. How's everything been going? What products are working? What are not working? Do you need additional services? Anything like that. I have in-person or Zoom meetings with the sales reps who are linked on my deals. So for example, DJ sold a customer 11 months ago, and I just had their renewal this month. And we went back and forth on Slack just to discuss the renewal. I updated him on everything, asked him a few questions. He asked me a few questions. So I interact with probably like 40 to 50 people on other teams a day. And then with my team, I obviously sit with my team and we, you know, chat about what's going on, you know, with our roles. But I really work a lot with people on other teams, more than people on my team.
That's cool. I also didn't know you and DJ worked together before this. So this is great that there's a lot of interaction just at that level. So that's awesome.
Yes.
And DJ, you mentioned you worked West Coast hours. So kind of what's that like in terms of your role?
Yeah. And Dana didn't mention that that company renewed. No big deal. Got him shut up. So West Coast, yeah. So I work about 10 to 7. So it's nice. I avoid rush hour. I drive in. So I'm in small business. So we actually work in a rotator model. So not everyone has an individual territory. So 15 of us have the whole Western side of the country, and you know, we just get rotated new leads. So I may be speaking with someone on a call from Denver, next call could be San Francisco, Phoenix. So it's cool because you talk to people that are in different parts of the country. And you know, for me, like my day to day, typically when I get in around 10, it's just mapping out the day. You know, I live and die by my calendar. I see what I have as far as calls. Typically I'll have 3 to 4 calls a day. That can be a combination of, you know, discovery calls, you know, first call with the company, figuring out if we're a good fit, product demos, and then maybe like a negotiation closing call. Those are my favorite because, you know, hopefully we get somebody signed up. But we run a monthly quota, so a lot of those closing calls are in the back half of the month. But, you know, the good thing with West Coast is, you know, a lot of them don't stay in the office past 4. So a lot of my calls are from about, you know, noon Eastern till about 5. And after that, it's just follow-ups. And, you know, if I have like a half an hour between calls, I'm, you know, just like Jenner's doing, I'm prospecting, trying to give people calls, get more meetings on there. And then, I head out. So I've done West Coast for a couple of years. I like it. It's only tough on Fridays in the summer when I want to get out of there, but it's good.
I know it's like everyone has kind of unique experiences depending on their territory, but like usually the day-to-day is like pretty similar. So I love that kind of insight there. And what's cool about kind of like our day-to-day processes is that we actually use our own products as our own sales hub in our everyday work. And that's where Flora sits in terms of the work that she does. So I'm curious, Flora, like how much interaction do you get with the teams when it comes to like using Sales Hub and like how that affects your daily work?
Yeah, definitely. I think there's a motto across all of HubSpot is like solve for the customer. And when the customer is just like across the street, definitely utilize that resource a lot too. So I think it's like kind of two perspectives. Like when I was a sales engineer, so much of my work was so team-based, whether it was like working with DJ and all the other sales reps in a team together and trying to figuring things out together, or working with different sales reps on that one-on-one for each deal or call and realizing that everybody has a different style and adapting to different styles. So much of that is just building that relationship with your teammates and your coworkers and getting to know them as people before just people that you're on a deal with together. And I think now kind of taking all these learnings and understanding like what do salespeople need and what are they motivated by and what excites them really helps like enrich my experience in product, because this is something like I build into the software, realizing like what the needs of the people are. So yeah, it really kind of goes both ways.
That's awesome. And I think you're kind of speaking on kind of the theme of empathy in a little bit, which actually kind of segues nicely into our next question. And I think actually it's our final question for the evening before we go into the Q&A, which is kind of thinking about how we think about culture. So if you haven't checked out our culture code yet, or if you've heard it ad nauseum, if you've chatted with me, it's one of our living, breathing documents that talks about what HubSpotters, how we define what HubSpotters should be and how we operate in our day-to-day. And we have 7 values that talks about that in depth. If you go to culturecode.com, you can read a little bit more about what these 7 mean in detail. But one of the things that we definitely look for when it comes to HubSpotters that come into our environment and add to our teams is that we look for people with heart. So people who are humble, empathetic, adaptable, remarkable, and transparent. And that empathetic piece was what I was touching on, Flora, in terms of like, who is the user and who are we always solving for? And I think that's always like one heavy one I see across our teams. But rather than have me tell you about kind of my experience with heart, I would love to just ask our team here as our final question of the evening, how have our operating values on the culture code and heart, how has that played into your role every day? So leave it to you guys.
I think that to kind of start at the end of heart, transparent is something that HubSpot does so well. DJ kind of touched on this earlier, but when you become a sales rep or even a renewal manager, when you get promoted, it's very clear what data you need to get promoted. And then everyone that gets promoted gets the same raise. So I think that our transparent, how everyone gets paid is really helpful. I also think that the management and leadership team is extremely empathetic. I know, over the past 3 years, I've had, things happen in my family, and I've been able to, take time off or work from home, or be able to put my personal life before work for a few days or a week or kind of whatever I needed. And it wasn't a big deal. It was no questions asked. It was, do what you need to do. That comes first. So I think that HubSpot truly puts the employee first, which is such a great thing to work at a company where you feel valued and respected.
Thank you for sharing that, Dana. Awesome.
Yeah, I'd say like heart, I know it looks a little cheesy and it's like a little hot sometimes, but it's like truly HubSpot, like we really believe in this stuff. And it's like company awards are based off of this. We base so much off like the literal operating system of the company on this concept of heart. So definitely, whether you guys are thinking of applying or in the application process, like I would really read the culture code and like think about, what aspects of these pieces of heart, like of heart that really resonates with you. I don't think it's like we all come in with all 5 like full on, but definitely like something that we all kind of aspire to in different ways. And I think for me, adaptability is something I'm always kind of working on, especially having shifted roles. It really kind of shows the tenacity of HubSpot, just how we launch new products all the time, new teams are being launched all the time. The core mission stays the same, but how we solve it has drastically changed in a lot of different ways. So how different roles and teams, like the ISC team was totally new and something that was with like initially with an experiment, but that we full on went into. And if you're someone who is adaptable, you kind of keep an eye out for things like that. And that's where real career opportunities can start. So I think that's something to really notice. It's like why heart matters at HubSpot.
Well said. I can't add to that.
Yeah, heart for me, actually, that's actually what sold me on HubSpot, to be honest. The actual culture code, when I was reading that and I was going and just applying to different places, when I read this, I was like, man, these guys are different. You know, if this is what everybody over here believes in, then I'd love to be a part of it. I'd be honored to be a part of it. And when I actually joined, I wasn't even surprised because that everybody literally has some of the, all of these values. I wasn't surprised at all. If you haven't read the culture code, it's amazing. Check it out. And just to touch base on adaptability as well. When I joined the ISC, the Inbound Success Coach Program last year, there was probably only about 17 people in that program. Now it's about 85 plus worldwide, which is awesome. But last year, it was first focused more on the sales aspect. We actually ended up merging with another team, which was mostly focused on service. It was our USC team. And we actually merged both of those together. So there was a huge learning curve that a lot of us had to do. But that's exactly why they hired you, because it's meant for people who are, you know, pick up, fit quick to your feet, are adaptable, and are ready to take on a new project and initiative like this and make it successful. So it's been an awesome experience just being around HubSpotters who have heart.
That's awesome. What about you, DJ?
I think you guys hit on a lot of the main points I would say, but I think adaptability is huge at HubSpot. I mean, it's a fast moving company. And I think, you know, what Flora touched on, like with that, a lot of doors can open up. And I think if you have a good attitude and you're always ready for you know, something new, something different, I think it allows you to grow. And it also just keeps things interesting. You know, I think the one thing I like is I'm not just selling one single product every day to the same type of people. There's, you know, 70 different products inside of HubSpot that I can talk about. And, you know, there's tons of different types of companies that I can speak with every day. So I think it, you know, keeps things interesting.
Awesome. And if you're wondering if we assess this throughout the interview process, we kind of said this a little bit, but we absolutely do. So if you haven't checked this out yet and you are looking to see if this is a great culture that really aligns well with you, I would definitely encourage you to check it out like everyone else is kind of promoted here. So I love that you're all able to share just like how this kind of personifies itself throughout the day to day. So I think with our last question there, I wanted to just make sure that before we jump into the Q&A with a few minutes left, and I know we started a few minutes late, so we'll go a few minutes past just to make sure we have time. But in case, if you loved what you heard and are interested in learning more about how do you kind of join a sales team like this one with these guys here, just so you know, two of the roles we are hiring for right now for any 2019-2020 grads are the business development rep role and the inbound success coach role. What we'll do is we'll send out the links to these roles right afterwards, so this way you can look at them in detail and also hear a little bit more from folks in those roles themselves. But these are the roles that we are hiring for right now for any January or summer 2020 starts. So if you're interested, you'll get an email with the links so you can read more about those. And in case you are interested in applying for those, we are having applications open until October 18th of 2019. So if you want to just kind of cut to the chase and apply, you're more than welcome to do so before you get the link from me. Feel free to just go to hubspot.com/students and you can find those links right on our students page there. So just so you know, those are there. Cool. So I want to make sure we have some time to answer some of these live these questions live. So if you haven't already, feel free to submit your questions. And with the amount of time we have left, we will make sure we answer any of the remaining ones via email so that you get those answers as you kind of want to learn more about HubSpot. So I'm going to stop sharing my screen for a second so we can read the questions. And then from there, we will then wrap up. So I would love to jump in and actually let's start with the first question in terms of Oh, are there any opportunities to travel within any entry-level roles to clients or to other locations?
I had the opportunity to do so. They pretty much sent me on a mission to go to Bogota, Colombia, and our Bogota office had just opened up. I was there for about 10 days. It was awesome. Bogota's a beautiful city, beautiful office, great people. And it was nice. It was pretty much expensed on HubSpot. So was able to stay at a nice hotel right next to the office. And the team over there took me out to dinner every single night. So it was great, man. Yeah.
Is that like kind of usual, or is that kind of like an occasional instance?
For myself, or
like in any kind of role, and DJ, feel free to chime in too if that travel's part of your role.
It's mainly inside sales, so really there's not too much traveling, but you know, there are different events we do, like Grow with HubSpot user groups. I know Flora is big with those type of events, but you know, we've got President's Club, so if you guys crush it, you know, there's a new trip every year, and I was able to go a few years ago, weird flex, but it was fun. It was Portugal. There's some opportunities here and there, but I'd say it's mainly, you're just in Cambridge over the phone.
Yeah, I'd say it's really based off of like a business reason. As fun as it sounds like to go on a business trip and everything, like it really depends on like if the business needs it for something. So like Jenner did like a pretty unique thing and be able to hire like someone in Bogota who has the skill set of like what they were looking for because he had those skills. So I think it really depends. That being said, like HubSpot's pretty like open and flexible to like making the business case. So what I like do like is that like, for example, I work with a lot of product teams who are in Dublin. So there've been opportunities to go there, or other times like people from sales teams have gone to visit customers if it was a large account. But like DJ said, it's mostly an inside sales job. So I would not expect that as part of the job.
And I saw that a lot of our panelists answered some questions from the Q&A too. So massive thank you to you guys for answering those. Those are part of the email too for any of those who missed it. Let's move on to the next question. We'll take a couple more, and then I want to make sure that we respect the time that we have. Oh, and the lights on. Like clockwork.
Yeah. I'm going to turn the lights on.
A question we could probably ask right now that's next on the list is, do you ever find that your job is monotonous with a lot of calling and selling? Does HubSpot do a good job of keeping it interesting? What do you guys think?
Take a stab at that one. I think, there's definitely times, I'll be honest, where it can feel monotonous. I think it fails. You know, there's days where you're just making a lot of calls. You know, you're not really, moving anyone across the line, it can get a little monotonous, but I think they do a good job of encouraging, like, take a break, go get a snack in the kitchen, like, talk to your manager. I think you don't have to feel like, you're trapped and doing the same thing. Like, if I'm having a tough day, I'll, maybe go downstairs and grab a drink, relax. Like, I think it's easy to get caught up in the day-to-day, but I think, like anything else, just take a break and try and break up the day.
That's great. And a lot of our offices are built so that there are spaces so that you can go reset, recharge, so that you're not stuck at your desk all day long or stuck doing things for hours at a time. I think for me, when I do phone interviews, like I'm usually at my desk from 9 to 5 and I forget to take a break and I realize I just want to go home afterwards and just not come out. So those are days where I want to avoid that. So I think remembering that is important. The next question that we have here is, what's the average time from an entry-level position to your first promotion? Do you have benchmarks for success to hold us accountable and let us know where we stand? I can definitely answer that from a general standpoint, and guys, feel free to jump in. I know that there are definitely specific growth plans built in for sales roles, especially if you're going from a BDR to a sales rep role, because we know that the growth desires to want to become an account executive to be in a closing role. And so every 4 to 5 months you are assessed so that you can see if you're performing well in your metrics and your quotas, then yes, we assess that and move you into an elevated role with some compensation changes, but so that you can achieve a role as fast as like DJ has, for example, in the 15 months that he took to become an AE, which is very traditional among sales reps at HubSpot. But that's the general sense, but team, feel free to jump in if there's any additional that you want to add to that.
No, I think you nailed it. You know, it's just, they have different goals you have to hit. And I think, you know, plenty of people get promoted each year from BDR to AE. I think it's a really good program, especially, you know, the last couple of years, really good leadership. And, you know, everyone who is a sales manager would always prefer someone who's homegrown, someone who's a BDR and gone through that program, because they already know HubSpot, they know the product, and it's just expanding on that, you know, those sales and closing skills. But you're putting yourself in a great position, you know, going through that program.
Yeah, and the promotion paths are pretty transparent as well. I mean, you're never going to feel lost that you don't know exactly where you're going. And if you feel like there's certain skills that you need to get better at, you know, your managers are there for you, your team is there for you, and they'll help you get there. You just got to be, you know, proactive and actually like speak exactly where you want to be and set expectations on your goals, your career goals. And the team around you is going to help you get there.
Anything else to add, friends? All right, cool. Let's move on to our last question, which I actually already have a slide for. And then any questions we didn't answer, we'll make sure we email them. And then we'll make sure that the ones that were answered by our panel in the Q&A box are sent out to everybody too. So let me just share my screen real quick just to answer the last question, which is, around the application process and how to kind of stand out. So, and actually there are a couple questions that ask about this. So for our sales roles in particular at HubSpot, these are the particular interview stages that you can expect to go through, from video interview to a phone interview with either myself or a member of our recruiting team. And then you'll meet a manager who would be either the manager of an inbound success coach team or a BDR team, just to get a sense for who you are as an individual, your career goals, experience, et cetera, and also vice versa. And then after the phone interviews, you would then go through an assessment where we're going to kind of put you in a situation where we're role playing an everyday situation in that role. So for things like the inbound success coach role, it's doing a demo with a customer to emulate kind of the type of education you give to a business using HubSpot. For a BDR, that would be probably an example role play of how you would ask questions to learn more about a business to help us understand if they're a great fit for HubSpot and then position the next step after that conversation. So we'll always talk about that a little bit more as you go through the process. So if you're looking for more, we can definitely answer those on a one-off. But then after the assessment, you would then move on to the final stage, which is what we call face-to-face interviews. So one-on-one interviews with managers on our sales team, so you can get a sense for who they are across the organization. So these are people you'd work with in different teams so that you can get a sense for how our sales team works across the business and also give us a chance to get to know you in a number of different dimensions as well. So we'll always be transparent about what we'll be talking about with those, but you can expect a lot of these to be talked about throughout your interview process. And some ways to stand out as a question that we saw in here is really be true to kind of who you are in terms of what inspires you, what motivates you, and also what's your connection to HubSpot and kind of the work that we're doing. A lot of times we hear that culture is the number one thing that brings them to HubSpot, which is great, which is not a bad thing to do. But I think for us, we want to be able to hear a little bit more of a deeper understanding about like, what is it about inbound? What is it about our customers? What is it about our business that you personally connect to, and how will you kind of help us solve for the customer in that way? So that was a really short answer, but we'll obviously talk about this. If you decide to apply, we'll talk about those ways in which you can continue to show your best foot forward and show us who you are. So that is our interview process in a nutshell. Feel free to insert more questions in there. But I think if you have additional questions, though, if you're not able to insert them here in the Q&A box, feel free to send us an email at campusrecruiting@hubspot.com, and myself and my team will help us answer those questions. But I think with that said, it is 7:06. And so as a way to wrap up, in case you like these webinars and want to check out some more, especially if you're interviewing and want to get some more interview tips, we've got an upcoming one at the end of the month where you'll meet with myself and a couple of recruiters to go through some interview tips and how to help you demystify some of those interview process a little bit more. And then we'll have some more webinars as we go into 2020. So we'll send out the links to these afterwards, but if you want to cut to the chase and beat me to it, check out our Eventbrite page at the link below. And with that said, now that it is past the 7 o'clock hour, I want to say massive thank you to all of our panelists for joining us and sharing your experiences and telling us more about kind of your journey and spending time with us. And also thanks to all of you for joining and asking so many in-depth questions. I think we've had the most questions here than we have anywhere else. So we'll make sure we answer these questions and send them out via email after today, as well as the recording. So massive thank you again. Someone said go Pats, so go Pats. I think the Pats are playing for the week.
Yeah.
So. I'm not a sports guy, so I'm just going to go with that. And I wish you all well. Have a great week and take care.
Bye, everyone.
Thanks, guys. Bye. Thanks, everyone.
Good night.